I'm Nicola Barber. I'm an instructor in biology, and I'm very new, two-month new. And I'm also a senior research associate with the Science Literacy Program.
Hey, thank you all for being here. Today's meeting will be just a little bit different, and I know our presenters envision this as a conversation, but let me start with some formal introductions. I'm very honored to introduce our guests who come to us from our counterpart institution up the road at Oregon State University. Our first guest is Dr. Martin Storksdieck, who is the director of the Center for Research on Lifelong STEM Learning, a name which is maybe about to change. They'll tell you about that. Martin came to Oregon State in 2014 from his previous appointment as the director of the Board on Science Education at the National Research Council for the National Academy of Sciences. Martin's research, he's primarily a learning researcher, so he's focused on out-of-school learning, voluntary learning, sometimes called free choice learning, and aspects of learning related to behaviors, identities, beliefs. Previously, he was at the Institute for Learning Innovation, which is a non-profit research institution on the East Coast, where he was a science educator. Where he was a senior researcher. He's also served as a science educator for a planetarium in Germany, and he holds degrees as undergraduate degree in biology, an MPA from the Harvard University Kennedy School of Government, and his PhD from Ufana University in Lumberg, Germany.
Did I get that right?
Kind of. Close. Spanish is my second language. And our second guest is Julie Risien, who comes to us also from the Center for Research on Lifelong STEM Learning. And she has been with the center since 2012, since it started, but also has a longer history at Oregon State University, where she was involved in the programs through Oregon Sea Grant and Institute for Natural Resources. Julie is involved in a variety of national efforts, including the NSF-funded Center for Advancement of Informal Science Education, known as CASE. She's on the steering committee for the NSF-funded National Alliance for Broader Impacts, known as NABI. I tend to see Julie in national meetings. We were just having a laugh more often than I see her in Oregon. She also serves as an advisor to the OSU Office of Research Development and has a background also working for nonprofit organizations in the Environmental Now Foundation and the U.S. Peace Corps volunteer. She holds an MS in Marine, a Master of Science in Marine Resource Management, and is also on the side working on a PhD in System Change and Transformation around institutional reform. So many hats, many skills. We are very pleased to bring these guests to share their perspective on university STEM centers, what and why.
We're having some
clearing out technologies.
Mac Windows issues right now.
She has a talk. A talk on hers. I have
mine on his. Our computers keep erasing the flash drive, so we're gonna.
So if any one of you, we'll start with me. That makes it easier.
Yes.
Would you like me to put it on a different device?
I can email it to you.
Yes. So we come here from the far north to talk about this. Some of you I've seen in the previous meeting when we had the state bring people together to ask how we as universities can help the state in CTE research. I think we were here in this room, remember? So thank you for having us to reflect a little bit about university STEM centers, what and why. We divided this up into two parts. I'll speak a little bit more about a broader context of STEM centers, of learning and STEM centers, and of scholarship. And Julie will introduce our STEM Center and what it is and what it does, and then quickly move to the broader context of how STEM centers are designed around the country, what purposes do they serve, and so on and so forth. So let me start with this by saying, as a Center for Research on Lifelong STEM Learning, a title we have to change in part because not even our staff can say it without choking, we are another research office. I report to the Vice President for Research, and as such, it is a center that Julie will get into this a little more in detail, that serves the entire university. The broader sense of bringing things together, of translating research into practice, and of doing applied research to inform practice in any discipline that OSU has. And in that sense, the word STEM is somewhat, how can I say that? It's both controversial and not. It is understood and not. In the world out there, the stem cells and the stem of a plant, and in the small world that we live in, it has some other meaning, but that meaning is not clear. Now, we have defined for ourselves what STEM is, because nobody owns the term. It was SMET before it became STEM. It was a convenient acronym before it became program. It was the S and or T and or E and or M before people made broader claims around that there might be something about them being connected. It has since these early discussions around the terms meant to STEM. In German, it's MINT. I'm German. That's MINT. We have that now too. So these ideas spread internationally. So the claim around this, as you probably know, maybe not, is not only that there is something that these four terms have in common, which is why we should put them in some bucket and give them money. At which point everybody else wants to be in that bucket, which makes it controversial. Because it says who's included and who's not. That's particularly around the term S. What science are we talking about? And different institutions have different definitions of what S is, whether you talk about the K-12 world, whether you talk about the State Department and who gets an extended visa so that they can stay around after they get their graduate degree here in the United States, depends on, you get that for an S, but only if it's the right one. And so this is political, this is power, this is money, and therefore it's controversial what is part of S. We take an extremely broad view of what S is. Whatever is science, and science can be the natural and physical science, it can be the social sciences, anything that creates evidence through some form of empirical approach. And that includes a very broad range of potential endeavors that universities embrace. We also, coming from a land, sun, space, and sea grant institution, realize that there's a lot of areas that we could call applied sciences that integrate them by definition of what they do, like the agricultural sciences, forestry, ocean science. And we had to actually call it out directly because lots of people think when you talk STEM, it's physics, chemistry, and biology. And you have to be, the other thing, you have to be inviting or else people feel rejected. That's something that we learned very quickly. I'd have to say that I have battle scars around what is STEM because I played, and I'll get to that in a moment, some role in Washington about doing some of this work, and people get very nasty very quickly when they feel that you might not include them. The other thing I want to mention about the term STEM is that, of course, in research, while the term STEM becomes increasingly more related to STEM learning and STEM teaching, and many of the disciplines would not consider themselves primarily STEM. I think physicists primarily see themselves as physicists and biologists as biologists, maybe as life scientists. And the term STEM takes a hold now in the education outreach and learning arena more than it does, I think, in the other ones, where people simply talk more about multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary, cross-disciplinary work rather than STEM. I want to mention, however, that of course it's clear that in order to do science, you need to use normally, there's a mathematical foundation to all of this. You normally do it with some kind of technology that has to be engineered. In order to engineer it, you need to do some science to optimize the engineering. And so there's some circles around this that intermesh things in a logical and coherent or not so coherent way. So that's the part that makes sense. The question now is in teaching and learning whether the claim around integration has something to it. So to what degree is it an S-N-T-N-O-N-E-N-M that we need for people to actually engage in these disciplines and learn them? And there are certainly different degrees of claims and counterclaims around this. And that makes an interesting segue to the broader idea of 21st century skills and what students actually should learn. Like, do you really need to learn a Krebs cycle with every enzyme that's in it and every little stage? Or what is it that you should learn? And it asks the question of what are the outcomes that we're aiming at? And that is something I think that's profound to our center, is to be thoughtful about the idea that, what do we mean when we say learning? How is learning connected to teaching, if at all? You know, the old joke that I taught my dog to count, one man says to the other. He says, well, show me. Well, I didn't tell him that he learned it. So and that sometimes seems to be philosophy in universities, that disconnect. But that said, one of the other things really is then the notion of what more broadly are we meaning when we talk about STEM education and STEM learning. We oftentimes now translate increasingly more into skills that we want students to have, which you can only get when they do some form of project-based, integrated, experiential learning. And so that seems to be the direction in which things go. It becomes a synonym for some form of approach towards teaching and learning that acknowledges and fosters broader skill sets, the ones that we actually need in life. And I sometimes quick, through STEM and 21st century skills, we're getting back to a good liberal arts education. Congratulations, we're back to square one, and we can't tell it as it is. So that's my little, what is STEM as a STEM center? We are a center for research on lifelong STEM learning rather than teaching. And that has to do a little bit, because we see that as foundational to the art, to both the art and the science of teaching and learning, is to actually think about what that is. I have a slide in here primarily because it has my son in here, and I just want to put it in here, as he experiences something in the world by picking up that stick. And so what is learning? Well, it's part of evolution. I'm actually a biologist. I got a master's degree in plant physiology, so I'm 1 year away from a PhD. So part of evolution, right? We adapt to a physical and social environment because we hatch incomplete. Of course, learning is at every level of organismic life, but that's particularly pronounced with us because we're so terribly incomplete when we come out. And we do this all the time, which we often forget. It's like the heart. The brain doesn't stop. And whether you are in a classroom or not, it's working. And we need to be acknowledging that just as much as we need to work with that. It is conservative. It's terribly conservative. It preserves and builds on tried and true. We talk about misconceptions that are so hard to break. Well, that is because we are designed to only go to the counterfactual if you have to. Because we are living in a world in which once you learn something, that is a good thing to have. Biologically speaking, we're not evolved for the world in which we currently live. And it's very needs-based. Everyone has a different personal sphere, a different social sphere in which we have to learn. And that makes it so important that we understand the personal motivation that people bring to this is not just an indulgence. It is an evolutionary need to adjust the learning process for you as an individual to the need that you have in your social and physical environment. And ultimately, it's group-based. We do this as social creatures. And it's these principles that drive to a degree what it means to do research on lifelong STEM learning. It doesn't matter where we do this research, we keep principles in mind that foster learning processes. That said, here it is again. We do this, this is something that now comes as, it was never new, but it is now much more acknowledged that learning is connected across time and space and settings, and that part of our job as educators and part of our job as researchers is to understand how these connections are made. So here's this little fella again, and he is immediately surrounded by lots of people he connects with that influence the way he experiences the world. Caregivers, role models, friends, family, peers, for better or worse, they influence what he does, what he pays attention to, what he learns, whatever that may mean. Then this is surrounded by another circle, and there's many different representations of this kind of model. And here are all these institutions that directly or indirectly are trying to convey something to the little guy here, and trying to have him teach or learn, either implicitly or explicitly. You know, trigonometry is not done necessarily at sports, but it's done in schools. And you can see this is really a lot of different institutions, either as educational institutions or as places where learning can happen in a positive or negative way. Let's take the internet or the media, where the free choice component of learning is very strong, but also the risk that you learn something you shouldn't be learning in the first place. But you can see lots of institutions in our environment that do this. From schools to hobby clubs to faith-based organizations, we learn at work, doing sports, and so on and so forth. And after school, they're all important, and they're all connected. Now, this is surrounded by another circle, and that circle is that which influences these institutions and the caregivers. Our values, our norms, the policies we have, the regulations, the history, the culture that we have, the social cohesion in our community, and so on and so forth. All of this is influencing the way that these things work, and all of that changes over time. I'm bringing this up because that is conceptually driving what we do, and I'm saying this also, it is increasingly more conceptually driving how people think about this in other places, including Washington, D.C. That brings me to broader trends that are represented in here. What I wanted to mention here is that all of what I said has a boatload of really good research connecting our understanding of teaching and learning with really good research. The National Academy of Sciences, where I've worked for 5 years, has churned out a lot of these during the time I was there, and I was responsible for some of them. And when I say responsible, it means there are an incredible number of people who have deep expertise who have come together and let us know what we know, what we don't know, and what we should know, what we kind of know, and then put it together in consensus reports. Can you imagine 12 academics coming to consensus on every word and every comma in a report about something as controversial as how to teach K-12 science? So anyway, it's a big process, and we have that, and what you will see now is this kind of process playing out in the last few years on a variety of things that I believe are very important for us to know, and we need to know where is this happening. But before I do that, just to get to the notion that much of the learning that happens, you have two different representations of lifelong learning, since that's in our title as well. The top one comes from a report from the National Research Council on lifelong learning, of informal learning. And it shows you that in the time that we have our waking hours, we spend relatively small amounts of times in formal environments. But we do that throughout our life. Of course, the bulk of that is because of compulsory schooling, actually compulsory education here, it doesn't need to be schooling, schoolings in other countries. We do that in formal structures. But a lot of the time we're spending, we're not doing this. That's where other forms of learning happen, in the community, at home, on the internet, when you watch TV, and so on and so forth. The other one is a similar representation. The message is much of learning happens outside of formal structures, and it happens throughout our life. So here are two reports that the National Academy of Sciences brought out that tries to summarize the scholarship in this. The left one, you may be familiar, maybe not, but 2,000 references are guiding what we can say. That was by 2009. It's been growing exponentially since. Enormous scholarship that tries to understand what informal, out-of-school, after-school learning is that happens when we watch TV, media, go to museums, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, we translated that into the Surrounded by Science to the Right is a report that says, and here is how you can make that happen. Now, increasingly more, and related to, so this part has a lot to do with what do you do when you want to bring your research, your science, as a researcher, to the public. So informal science education is a component of that. The other component of that is chemistry, is communication. Here are two reports from the National Academy of Science that are extremely new. One is on effective chemistry communication, and this was a deep dive in how researchers can better communicate their science to the public in chemistry. You say, why is NSF funding chemistry? They actually asked us the question, why should we give you this money to do this report to just find out in chemistry? And we said, because chemists don't talk to physicists, and physicists don't talk to biologists, and we know that from the degree to which that happens in what's called discipline-based education research, where we had to do a report, and the report, and we'll get to that, was done by the disciplines because they are silos at this point. We try to break that. There's another one that came out on science literacy. What does it know that the public knows, and how does it know? So that report's coming out, and they show the scholarship that we, if we don't know that scholarship, and if the institution doesn't know that scholarship, you're way behind it. Now, I talked about this connected learning. Here are two reports that look at this from the National Academy, again, all in the last few years, that look at the scholarship around these claims of connected learning, of learning across the lifespan, of learning across institutions, and of the idea of creating ecosystems of learning that we need to curate if we want our researchers to be successful. Now there's this thing called K-12, which is the $600 billion industry. Higher education is smaller. What is it, $400 to $500 billion, right? So this is a major industry. Trying to shift this industry with all its competing claims and its competing actors is a major endeavor. Now, what we did in the last few years is trying to put this on a different track. The Titanic, that is called K-12, likes to plow through icebergs best as it can because it has a hard time moving, and it's actually easier for that Titanic to go through the iceberg than to try to circumnavigate it. And it normally survives that with lots and lots of repairs needed, but it works quite well. Now we try to change that a little bit by coming up with a new framework for how science should be taught. And there's an equivalent of that you've heard, of course, Common Core. So this led to new science standards called NGSS, Next Generation Science Standards, which changed the conversation around what it means to learn by bringing the scientific and engineering practices to the forefront and say, you should learn science the way science is done. That has huge implications, and there's somebody smiling because she knows what comes next, which is once you say, these are the new standards and how you teach it, then quickly somebody says, on how do you assess it? Well, we thought about that too, and created a report, and Kathleen Scalise was one of those many experts that we rely on, who has to come to consensus with her other 11 colleagues without killing anybody in the process. So we came up with a report that says, well, exactly. And I agree, that's totally broken. So this was an important report that allows us not only to understand how we assess learning in K-12. This was a way, a deep dive into understanding how do we know that somebody is competent when they learn science. Now, how do teachers learn that? So here's another report that came out just in the last few years on the idea that teachers are a profession that has its own internal rules. And we have often talked about pre-service and in-service teacher professional development. Who of you was a pre-service physicist? You were a pre-service physicist.
Yeah,
yes.
Sure.
Yeah. One of the few areas where you are already the professional when you enroll in the classes, which is very odd. But this was a report that tried to understand what is the professional pathway of a teacher and how can we support that in a more logical way. The original idea behind that was to say, here are the 10 things you should never ever do in teacher professional development. We didn't get that far. And of course, there's policy implications. So we brought reports out that say, how do you actually go about changing standards and making them stick in classrooms and out of school settings? Because it turned out that very few people understood the whole system of education such that you know where the best levers are. So we actually created a report on that. And then there's this idea of STEM. Yeah, there's a whole report on how to integrate STEM and what are the claims and counterclaims around that and how can this be done in classrooms and out of classrooms. Lots and lots of ideas here. Oh, we're at a university, right? Universities have big problems at this point in time with undergraduate education. I want to say that many of the reports are mirrored by reports that come out of the White House. The White House has generated reports on these issues as well, and other associations do that. That create political urgency around the idea that associations, national associations, including the National Academy of Science, is picking on certain topics and said we should be focusing on that. One of the things that was really important is currently majorly in discussion is the idea that undergraduate education in STEM and elsewhere is suffering from lots of problems that need to be fixed, including the idea that we do a fairly lousy job in having equity in the way in which we teach and which we provide opportunities. But also problems with understanding how people can be on successful pathways out of high schools into potentially two-year institutions, increasingly more, and then moving into four-year institutions, and what it means from there to go into jobs. And how do we make that happen in such a way that we don't systematically discriminate against groups that are underrepresented in some of the areas? This is in part based on research that we've always done. Here's discipline-based education research, a report that looked at the strength of the research being done on how you teach physics, chemistry, engineering, and so on and so forth at the undergraduate level, and derived out of that recommendations on how we should change our education system at the university level, grades 13 to 16. And in order to make that happen, there was an accompanying report that says, and this is what you could do to tackle this. I'm bringing this up because, and there haven't even, there's a similar thing now happening with graduate education. All of this is to say that there is tremendous depth of expertise and evidence that is easily accessible and unfortunately very little used, particularly by people outside of this little bubble of education speak that we inherit and that we live in. And part of a STEM center in our world is to make sure this is accessible to people who are not in it, and that we are actually adding knowledge and evidence to strengthen these reports and make it come alive. And with that, I move over to you.
Did it work?
Well, not sure, but
my computer tends to crash.
As we are now trying to deal with the fact that we're not technologists, maybe people have questions.
And I can start with no visuals because I don't have that much, so we'll get started, and then that way we can have a more comprehensive conversation. So I'm Brian's counterpart down at, up at Oregon State, and Brian and I have been colleagues and for a while and friends for longer, so we've known each other for a long time, so I do have a sense that our center is unique among STEM centers because of our research focus, but also quite different than STEM Core. And Brian and I check in frequently to kind of assess those differences and try to understand how we're similar and how we can learn from each other. So this is great to be here, and I really appreciate the opportunity. Looks like you're not getting it, so I'm going to go for it. So we are, like Martin said, the Center for Research on Lifelong STEM Learning. That's riddled with problems. We're in the middle of changing our name for the Center for the STEM Research Center. And research is a really important aspect of what we do. And we are focused across the lifespan and throughout that kind of whole ecology of learning, as Martin said. We do research, but we are not sort of purists, right? We're not really interested in doing research unless there's a connection to application. So our vision is really that evidence from research and wisdom from practice are both guiding our learning systems.
Kathleen, we're just warming up here.
Oh, you are? You got it on PC and put it. Yeah. Get a visual. Okay.
And we have a broad range of partners, both internally at OSU and externally. So we have a piece of what we do is focused on changing practices around undergraduate education. A piece of it is around STEM education and more broadly 21st century skills like communication, things in the graduates, at the graduate and postdoc level. And then a huge part of our portfolio is more the broader the broader ecosystem, probably pretty reflective of the life-wide graph, right, in terms of the dollars and efforts, relatively speaking. We have four researchers and three administrative folks, and we need about triple that probably to do what's on our plate. So it's not an unusual thing at STEM centers to have a lot of demands for service, especially internal in the university, and not an investment necessarily that matches that. And that's partly because STEM centers are finding their identity, figuring out who we are, and how we're all very unique and different and responsive to our own institutional needs. There is a really busy landscape of STEM activity, of which focusing on undergraduate STEM is, you know, maybe where we are and a huge part of it, but there's also so much activity around industry and workforce and changes in policy, and obviously K-12. Funders are trying to figure out their way through this and what kind of contributions they want to make, and people at STEM centers are the ones that are trying to articulate that. We're trying to kind of come together on a national scale and help guide funders on what the real needs are. The resources are very dispersed and not necessarily always in communication. There's a lot of activity right now for instance, associations that the universities work with, AAU, APLU, AACNU, to come together to start to inform the process, right? So they're informing funding agencies, they're working together. So Brian and I both serve in a network that feeds part of that process. I'm just gonna skip the slides. I'm over it. And so of STEM centers, I think there are over 300 entities at universities that call themselves STEM centers. But there's a huge array of what those centers do. So some may be solely focused on pre-college, out-of-school experiences and programming. Some are doing a lot of work with broader impacts, working with their faculty in sciences and engineering in particular, and sometimes computer sciences, on developing really high quality broader impacts, evidence-based broader impacts, evaluating broader impacts is also part of it. A lot focused on graduate education, and the bulk is focused on kind of K-12 teacher preparation and things like research experiences for teachers. Or outreach, science outreach kind of activities. I'm on my last slide, you guys.
You can go to the slides in a moment.
No, I don't need to. This is a good exercise for me. So I wanted to just sort of pick on one issue. Martin brought up equity and access to education, and this is, I think, probably one of the most challenging issues facing universities. We were with APLU. Executive VP, was that yesterday?
Yes.
Day before. It's been a really first. Long week. And you know, he threw up this graph that was really compelling to me, which I'll just describe to you. But it's in income quartiles, and we've been working so hard to raise the equity in STEM education in particular, but education broadly. And in the last 13 years, we have made no progress when you look at access to education and in income quartiles. It is just flat across the board. And so I have this sort of 55% chance of succeeding in higher education. And somebody in the lowest, well, I don't know if I'm in that quartile actually, 25% maybe of succeeding in education. And someone in the lowest quartile has less than 10%. It's actually gotten a little bit worse in the last 6 years. So that was just something that's been kind of compelling to me. I really am on the last slide. It's okay. Don't even try. You're just distracting everyone. go all the way through the end, please. Yeah.
You've missed this one.
So
yeah, listen.
No, keep going. Yeah.
This is the graph.
So STEM centers are kind of, a lot of STEM centers are at the heart of, okay, let's try something different. And what's hard, I think, for centers is that universities don't know what to do with us. We're not really teaching entities, and we're not research entities, and we're not admin. So what are we? Where should we sit? How do we work across? And everybody is grappling with that. Our colleagues are grappling with that. And the goals are really diverse. This is just a smattering. You know, we're about improving learning outcomes in all kinds of settings, formal and out of school, throughout the lifespan, but a lot of us with a lot of focus on undergraduate. We're about preparing the workforce in a different way, not just to have the technical skills, but to also have the skills to collaborate and communicate and kind of overcome some of our big problems. A lot of people work on pathways issues, on connected learning and the ecosystems. So this is just a group of things, but we have these really hard to pin down roles because, like I said, we don't really fit. So we do research, but a lot of STEM centers don't necessarily do research, but they might be deeply involved as partners in research. Their application of evidence-based practices, again, in all of those settings that we're talking about. We do a lot of educator development, all types of educators, museum educators, undergraduate instructors, senior tenured faculty who may have learned very, very well that way that they learned when they went to college, but that just doesn't really work if we're looking at an equitable education system. And there's a lot of brokerage of information and partnerships, and a lot of convening, like this group, STEM Corps, right here. And then, of course, the programs, which we all know take a lot of time. So I think part of the challenge for STEM centers is being able to, one, be clear with themselves and the people who support them about how much energy these things take, about the degree of social capital involved. And you guys are the core, right? So I don't have to tell you that, because you're clearly spending your energy building your social capital among each other. And I would imagine, if I could imagine this as a community of practice, with you guys at the core, and there are people who are benefiting and maybe occasionally contributing, kind of a larger group of people, and probably even a larger group that's getting something out of this, but not necessarily contributing and kind of constructing new information together with you. And that's really where I wanted to leave it for the conversation to start. We do too much with too little, and every STEM center is being asked to do too much with too little, and we're all having, sorry, it's a grant day, we're all, I've got emails coming up on mine, but you're obviously not seeing it. We all have really not a clear path on how we overcome those challenges and how we demonstrate that bringing people together across these silos to collaborate, to innovate, to evolve new structures, how valuable that can be to universities. The other thing, we talked at lunch a little bit, you know, if we're doing it right, if we're convening people or bringing people together across silos right, nobody will ever know that we did it, because it worked. And the people that did cross the bridge, you know, not the people who built the bridge, are the ones who kind of get the credit in that situation. And I'll end there. You missed the last one.
No, I actually.
Oh, you didn't have the last one.
No, I showed it for a while.
Okay.
This one was up.
Yeah. Well, we can close it down.
I don't know if there are any burning questions. I have a question for the audience, which is, I mean, you all are obviously participating in this meeting convened by STEM Corps, but I'd love to hear, and I'm sure Martin and Julie would appreciate hearing your perspectives as to how, you know, what role do you see STEM Corps playing in your creative activities, and did anything resonate with you in their presentation?
And those are two different questions.
Right. Well, I guess the resonate part is something we are doing or could be doing.
Well, one thing that struck me as you laid out is the extent of the research and the extent of your activities. It made me realize that as we, you know, go through our periodic panic of applying for grants, that much of what we do is to say, okay, what is this RFP want, and what do I do that could fit in to the questions that they think are important, even though we just last month sent essentially a proposal for the same activities but refocused to address someone else's need. Do you have a sense of if that outer circle of power and policy were not there, and you could just focus on the issues of learning and success in life, of the big issues that you're aware of, do you see ones that you think are really the keys, whatever a particular office of Natural Science Foundation say happen to be funding? You mentioned equity as being one of the really big ones. Are there some other priorities that are just stand out? Like if somehow you don't address that, other issues may not be, we may be kidding ourselves that other issues will be as well.
So I think the first one is indeed equity, because we will recreate structures that just recreates privilege. And there's a natural tendency to make that happen, that without intervention, the tendency is for an unequal way in which resources are distributed. This is almost like a law of economics. And much of what happens here is to try to counter that. So that's an important part. The second part, and here's what you think of others, is frankly the application of what we know to what we do. I think we are, and in general, we have a hard time creating systems as human beings. We have done that a lot. Systems in which what we know works well is being transported down the next generation. Think about the medieval apprenticeship system in the trades. And for the longest time, that medieval apprenticeship system was what we did in education until we started the factories. And whereby when we started the factories, the main ones that actually create widgets were then recreated in terms of educational factories, called schools and universities. When universities opened up increasingly more, then they became factories as well. But a little bit of that apprenticeship system is still in graduate education, but we are losing that now. So I would argue that that is needed in order to actually, a lot is needed in order to have the structures that allow us to apply what we know and to increase what we know.
So I have almost the same answer. Equity and access for me, if we don't do better, what is the point of the rest of it? Because we're just recreating how we got here.
Yeah.
And I guess my take is just only slightly at a different angle, which is the cultures that do recreate those structures. So part of equity is not just lifting someone up so they can participate in the system that we've created, but it's allowing the system to change in ways that make us uncomfortable. And in ways that incite a lot of resistance. And it's very, very apparent right now that culture, the changing of culture is terrifying to people. And so it's still equity though. It still has to do with equity, and that's not about race, and it's not about economics. It's about the richness of the landscape from which we can draw to innovate and solve problems.
I don't know what other thing.
Yeah.
You know, and out of all that research about equity and bringing that back to be your top priority, do you see any of those silver bullets, the things that need just things we know that just need to be done, and then equity problem would start to turn around?
Yeah, that's
any of
little,
that part of what we know in golf, we have these good practices that nobody's implemented.
This little pill we have to take, and then all will go away.
Yeah.
Which is why we have RCTs in education research. I have a very, an unsatisfying answer to that. There is no silver bullet because the system is so highly complex that there cannot be a silver bullet. What it is, we have to address the issue at the systems level at all levels that you can, which is what frustrates policymakers to no end. When education people start talking about the idea, well, what you see right now, of course, is the system is being badgered with these silver bullet solutions. Okay, we have more choice, school choice, that will solve it. Change the class size, that will solve it. Have every undergraduate do research, earlier the better, that will solve it. And then they glum to this. And the risk is that they glum to this, they try it, it doesn't work because it can't. From the theoretical perspective, it can't. And then it frustrates people and they say, well, there's no good evidence, you guys are not giving us any good ideas, there's no science to this, and we can't rely on anything you say. Well, that's because you wanted to take a pill. And that, to me, is the biggest problem in the policy arena, that the attention span to the complexity of the issue leads us from one reform jump to the next, when in fact we get tired of it, and in fact the whole model is wrong.
So one example, there's not, and I think in fact the opposite is true, is that we keep finding things that we think this will be it, and we just have to do it. So a good example in undergraduate instruction is a Freeman paper that sort of highlights the evidence-based instructional practices such as interactive engagement, frequent forum feedback, are disproportionately benefit minority and first-generation students, which is a huge meta-analysis, and there's a ton of data behind that. But in practice, what you find is it depends a lot on how you use those evidence-based practices. So just infusing
every single classroom with that doesn't actually change the landscape. And for some people, it makes it worse. And so, you know, being able to, and university presidents or you know, people who come and do their public speaking event love to be able to glom onto something like that and say, here, it's simple, and why aren't we changing, and why is our culture so recalcitrant to this? But there's a lot of danger in that, and it is so highly complex, which is why I feel compelled to study this type of thing in my spare time.
Good quote from, Carl Wieman is a Nobel Prize winning physicist who moved after he got his Nobel Prize to improving physics education. And there are others who did that, highly ranked physicists who put their weight behind that. And he was the chair of my board before he stepped down. I came on as a new director with a new chair, Harold Quinn, another luminary in physics. And he said, in the research he did on educational research, undergraduate education, he said, you know, the physics stuff I did to get a Nobel Prize was really, really simple compared to what I now have to deal with. Trying to understand how to improve classroom practice and outcomes for students. Now, he's not the only one who said that, and so he might have it from someone else, but it's his experience that he has, and he's a very serious man. So I find that really an interesting metaphor. And I find it interesting that many in the physical and natural sciences don't have that understanding about the complexity of the social sciences, and that leads to a lot of conflict in my mind in academia. But also in the public realm than about how quickly we should fix things.
I feel like one way we won't get there is with metrics. I don't think metrics get us there. I think metrics can indicate things to look deeper at. But you know, we have the same kind of targets for things like graduation rates and that you guys have here. And it's easy, we can meet those. There's lots of paths to meeting those. That have lots of unintended consequences.
Are there positive examples that you can think of systemic success, of systems that have changed in our area where they've avoided the list of pitfalls that you just presented?
I'm thinking of things Howard saying in his talk.
I think
it was interesting to have somebody from the Association of Public Land Grant Universities. So I think they have 225 member institutions. UL was one of them. And did you know that? I looked it up just to make sure before I came. But he came to OSU, and some of our undergraduate reform efforts, from his perspective, we're quite evolved, and we feel like we're drowning. We're barely getting anywhere. And so I think that gave us a really strong sense of the relative successes that people have had trying to kind of change systems. And I think that the successes, and this is really just about undergraduate instruction, the ones that kind of, what they call the squeeze effect, which is, you know, there's bottom-up change and there's top-down change, and neither one really get you there until you kind of squeeze the people in the middle. And it's mostly department chairs in the undergraduate realm that really have that control. Mm-hmm. And it's not to say department chairs are to blame. It's to say department chairs are the kind of most easily empowered, that give you the most bang for empowerment buck.
I know that.
So that's not a very satisfactory answer, but it's put it in perspective for us, I think, a little bit.
I have a good one that is also an interesting signal about how difficult it is. So Freeman Hrabowski is the president of the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, and he's pretty much nationally famous for having done enormous strides in progress through a variety of very nationally well-known programs on increasing STEM graduation rates and the participation of underserved minority groups, primarily African Americans. And it's fantastic, and he's featured and in many places, and he gets phone calls to become the president of another university and do something similar there all the time. One thing that's interesting about this, so here's somebody who paid close attention, put his entire leadership team on it, used resources for it as part of the university succeeding, not as part of being like socially aware. No, he made that commitment to excellence by by going into the realm of saying, I'm gonna support diversity very successfully. The programs that he has, and this is where it's a cautionary tale as well, cover about 10% of his students. So the question that I had is, why aren't you doing this for everybody? Well, guess what? Because it's too costly. Now, one would argue it probably can be done with less cost if you scale it up more. But there's an issue here. It's interesting to see. Somebody has used a lot of research that supports ways in which to make a university more inclusive. And who's probably the best at it, by some account, he can only go so far. So that's a cautionary note. Great success, but partial.
Could you say more about what you said before about how active learning management in the classroom, in theory, is very effective, and in practice doesn't seem to impact equity? How do we know that?
I don't want to say in practice doesn't. I want to say every single practice is unique, right? So, for example, we have a wonderful, young, brilliant professor and assistant professor in math, who in mathematics, as I always like to get reminded, who is using evidence-based practices. There's just slews of evidence for, and quite a lot that says that there's this unequal positive impact for first-generation or minority students and underserved and general students. And she is, she's using them and finding that, and for some of those practices, that's actually not the case. And she's trying to fine-tune and get to the nuance of where you hit that, right? And so sometimes that has to do with the actual backgrounds of the students you have in your class might be very different from the backgrounds in that paper. So I think of, Raymond Spassky's university, and the things that are working there, that would be very different in Oregon, right?
Oh, yeah.
Who is underserved and what their life experience is coming into a university as underserved and what their relative experience is to the students who are well-served is completely different. And I think, so what my point was sort of, some of that is like masquerades as a silver bullet, and if it's taken wrong and applied in not very thoughtful way, and often we forget the nuance and how important and how sensitive learning is to its environment.
This is the HHMI, and I think you guys are applying for one of those grants now. HHMI is giving some money out, and there's other funding for that, to bring ideas of equity and inclusion and to counter implicit bias and other kinds of things into the disciplines themselves. So to rethink the way we teach things like physics and chemistry in large lecture courses and in seminars by addressing these issues everywhere where they encounter, rather than by making it a separate piece. And I think that's one of the problems that we're encountering. There's this other layer on top of the best practices in teaching and learning that may have been developed as you rightfully say, under completely different circumstances. And then when you don't address, let's say, those issues simultaneously, then they may wash out the other stuff. So, which then again sounds like, oh, terrible, now I can't do anything, I'll go back to my lecture. No, that's of course not true. So you can't, but you can't sort of say necessarily solve at the beginning every problem at once.
One thing I wanted to make sure that people had the opportunity to talk about was broader impacts. I know it's been it's something that Brian and I talk about a lot. We talked about a little bit with Dean and others at lunchtime. You may or may not know, both Brian and I are involved with the National Alliance for Broader Impacts, which is actually NSF-funded, very interesting, NSF-funded research coordination network to try to advance practices around broader impacts. At times it feels like NSF's way of pushing itself to really kind of come together on their practices and their policies, because that's a large role of what the Alliance does.
And the most practical product of this group is the guide that I share with every PI, which is a guide for instituting or for developing broader impacts, right? Sort of a step-by-step guide.
Right. Has anyone in here used or accessed this? So I will tell you that this was something that came from the National Alliance for Broader Impacts, and
we didn't know what was going to happen with it, and we weren't even sure NSF was going to allow us to publish it because it puts a lot of words in their mouths. And they not only did they do that, they had boxes and boxes and boxes delivered to their headquarters, and some of the programs are actually using it as part of their training their panels and getting their panels up to speed. So there's some serious uptake going on. It is not ubiquitous. There are still programs for sure at NSF that I think maybe operating under the illusion that this is going to go away again. It went away once before, why not again? But that's very much the exception now, which is different than 12 years ago or 10 years ago, where that was really more the rule, and the people who were taking it very thoughtfully and seriously were more the exception. So I just wanted to make sure we brought that up, to have the opportunity to talk about it if people wanted to ask questions. I just came from a four-day trip to NSF and had incredible access through the National Alliance for Broader Impacts with the directorate heads and some of the really active mover and shaker program directors as well.
So with that in mind, what did you hear in terms of the resource base with which to carry out Broader Impacts and how that's evolving nationally?
So I can tell you what I heard about NSF's expectations of how their resources are allocated towards Broader Impacts. And again, practice is not ubiquitous across programs or directorates necessarily, but the expectation, as it says right there in the grant proposal guidelines and in the newest version as well, is that if you are proposing Broader Impacts, you better make sure you have the expertise on your team. You've got the evidence to back up what you're doing, or you're planning on generating some new evidence if you're innovating, which is a totally acceptable thing to do also. And you better have some budget to back it up. Now, that's going to be very different, right? Just depending on the scale of grants. But what they are starting to see is that there's such high volume of grants that fall into the excellent and very good categories that they start making decisions on things like, well, these two are great, they both have great Broader Impacts. This one's gonna be able to pull it off because they've pulled together the right partnerships with the right expertise, and they actually budgeted it, and this one's not. So there's those kinds of decisions are starting to get made. So does that answer your question, Dean?
Yeah, are they anticipating sort of looking at, say, the Broader Impacts parts proposals, pieces of proposals that were funded versus those that weren't, and sort of doing, you know, looking for some characteristics of one versus the other?
Yeah, so there's a lot of work around that. You may want to speak to the AAAS thing, but I'll get it started. So I have actually attempted to do my own analysis, and I will tell you that because the decisions are very opaque, because of the volume, and the higher the volume that NS gets in, and the lower the fund rate, the more opaque the decision making becomes. And this is something that they acknowledge themselves. We already talked about this a little bit, but I'll share it again for the benefit of everyone. Is that, you know, if your intellectual merit is just kind of okay, and your Broader Impacts are really not good, your reviews might be your Broader Impacts are terrible, and you might not get anything else. And the opposite is true. If your Broader Impacts are really good and your intellectual merit is just okay, you might only get feedback on your intellectual merit. And so it's really hard, even if you had the reviews, and this is one thing I've worked with, is I trying to get the reviews from everybody I work with, even if they don't get the grant, to try to understand, what do we do that helped you? What could we have done that would have helped you more? And there is almost no pattern. And that's a really hard thing to really grapple with. So the way that, you know, in practice you overcome that is working directly with the program officers to know what are the expectations, what are you going to be talking to the panel about, what Broader Impacts are. Do you think Broader Impacts only are these suite of things, or is what I'm thinking about going to be relevant? Because those are become highly personal program level decisions.
What you suggest, though, is that it's a it's a weak link system, sort of like No Child Left Behind. That is, if you miss your target on even one of the attributes, then you're graded on that missed target, not on
That's the way that it's talked about now. I think in practice there are still some programs where it's not quite true. But certainly, you know, they sort of are, like, it's a numbers game at this point. It's not that they're not taking broader impact seriously. It's that if you're not, as a proposer, as someone proposing, there's no way you're going to kind of rise to the surface.
So here's your risk you're running. Do you have a panel that is old school and a program officer who's old school? Or do you get somebody who actually takes what Franz Cordova says seriously, that's the director of it, and takes that seriously? So you're gambling. You're gambling whether a broader impact makes a difference or not on the margin. It's on the margin, probably still to a large degree. The intellectual merit, the talking to your colleagues, still outweighs the broader impact, talking to everybody else. But it is increasingly more a risky gamble you're running if you don't do it right. So I would say that's for sure. The answer to your question, NSF doesn't have the capacity to do these studies. We all think as a research organization they could do research on themselves. They can't. I'm actually a co-PI on the Center for the Advancement of Informal Science Education. In its new iteration, where we are now refocusing it to look at the intersection of informal science education and science communication. And that brings us much more into this realm where we want to understand broader impact fulfillment in all the other areas of NSF. And it turns out we want to work with other research centers to find out, but it's really difficult to do that.
NSF does hire outside firms to come in and look at specific programs.
That's what they can do.
Could set something up to do this as well. I don't think they really have a
So yeah, they're
yes,
I would agree. Yeah.
And they sometimes do evaluations of programs. But the idea of looking across, for instance, even a comparison between who got a grant and who didn't, very, very difficult, because the moment somebody is not funded, that is not public domain, and it's hard to get to, and so on and so forth. But it's really difficult to do the kind of systematic research you would want to do that would get you kind of like an estimate of the significance at this point in time and whether it changes.
The other thing too is, you know, there is still the space for a broader impact to be the weight of the new information that could come from the research. That's still there. It's still a space. It's less likely to get the kind of success without broader impacts, unless it's really well articulated what the uptake of the outputs from that research are going to be. It doesn't have to be with K-12, and it doesn't have to be an outreach uptake. It could be an industry uptake. It could be a public safety issue. It could just be dissemination within colleagues. But you still now you can't just say, well, that happens because I publish. Now you have to say, that happens because I bring my colleagues together and we work with that information and we try to map the path for applying that information and how that makes the world a better place. So you can't, even if it's the weight of the research that's so very important, you still need to be able to articulate the path between it just being inherently important and being realized as important. And so that's, I think, been an important distinction.
Yeah, I had just changing the subject entirely. So
far,
it goes back away. About access, two questions that I think are kind of the University of Oregon College of Ed focused interests. One, how do you do with accessibility and special needs with these, all the rich new NGSS, and this is K-12, approaches to science education. What do you have? You have reflection on the emerging evidence base around how to teach and how to assess to students low vision, low hearing, so forth, to allow all students to learn. That's one question. And second, I didn't see in your diagram, but early childhood education in STEM. So those two, strong interest here in our college.
So from my perspective on the broader STEM landscape and discussion, the latter one finds resonance, the former one does not. So meaning that through the White House, through OSTP, through initiatives nationally that recognize early childhood education connected to of course Head Start and the reformation of that and so on and so forth, Really, childhood education is strongly acknowledged now in STEM as something where you need to prepare people early on for the career. But I have to admit that the idea of thinking through like universal design principles, both in terms of delivery and assessment, and I know you brought that up in some other discussion, I don't see it very, I mean, in the museum world, of course, you have a universal design thing, but it's a pocket here and there. Mm-hmm. So I see this as a huge gap that is not very well addressed and requires more focus.
But for which there are legal requirements that this be met, and that if you don't meet it, you're subject to legal penalties.
Yeah, but it penetrates so much deeper than what the legal requirements force you to do. That I think it's not very well met. So when I think about, okay, what does it mean to do research in a more exploratory dimension? What does it mean to do experiential learning when you have limitations in where you can go, what you can see, what you can touch, what you can hear, what you can feel? That's a real problem. And lots of institutions, I think, are not set up. They're barely set up to provide that for the most able people. And then they're struggling with everybody else. I mean, legal requirements, be it as it may. And particularly if you get outside the K-12 now, great that they're getting more strides there, but outside of that.
My center has done some work in this area, but there's another issue going on in the same thing, in that the notion of what counts as being accessible and how you demonstrate that it's accessible, mm-hmm. and are things actually accessible, the standard for hundreds of years, if not thousands of years, is that anything is better than nothing. Mm-hmm. And we're only now getting to the place where there are choices. And there's almost no research base around, well, if you provide accessibility in this way as opposed to that way as opposed to something else, there might be a range of impacts here, and we might choose to do it this way. But nobody's researching that. I was at a conference where somebody from Reed Elsevier was there, thinking about how to make their journals accessible to visually impaired.
Yeah, yeah.
They say, we publish 4 million images a year.
Yep.
We have no idea how we would do anything, much less something that's effective, with 4 million images a year.
Even though there, interestingly enough, are legal requirements, and when you want to be compliant.
Yes.
So when I was at the National Academy, we were sensitive towards that, and it's quite a thing. I remember, so this is an anecdote, but there was a recent NPR, a documentary about, where did I see this, about what it means to be physically limited to doing research. And they showed a researcher who had a physics lab, a very active physics lab, and he barely maneuver. He was in a chair, and I'm not sure, I don't really understand anymore what it exactly was that limited him physically, but he could only operate in an electric chair that he could barely. And it was interesting, he talked very eloquently around the idea that it's not my limitation, it is my surrounding that limits me. And went, oh, it was shown in advance, in our advanced class. It is the surrounding that limits what I can do, and I can overcome that if people are willing to let me. I'm not deficient. And that was an interesting thing, but I think we're way there.
I think at the very, going kind of back to, I agree that a lot of the big, broader impacts, a lot of the things that the NSF considers in the way that they measure them, particularly related to disability, is kind of atrociously bad and is barely on the blip. But over the last 6 years, I've spent a lot of time in the engineering research centers, which are heavily, there's a lot of oversight, and that oversight tends to reflect the larger NSF ethos. Issues around disability and counting disability, I know it's not sufficient, but you know, in the world of if it's on their radar, things change. Counting individual disabilities and focusing on individual disabilities is definitely on the radar. It's the thing we got beat up about in our own reviews.
That's good.
So I think it's coming, and I suspect it's coming in part as a veterans issue.
Yeah, that really is a good thing to mention, because one thing I wanted to say about broader impacts is, and this was very clear, and there's been some confusion about broadening participation in STEM. And what we have started seeing, some of you have probably seen certain calls for proposals have, they have some language about broadening participation. And it can be taken as a PI as, oh, my broader impact needs to be a broadening participation impact. That's not what it is. It's, you better do your broader impacts, whatever they are, and you better be doing your research in a way and moving through your processes as a researcher or as a team in a way that actively works to broaden participation. It's not your broader impact. It is required on its own, and they are, NSF is working really hard to get kind of shared meanings across the programs around that. So that is a, I've actually consulted and I've read some RFPs and thought, oh, it looks like they're prescribing broader impacts, which they said they would never do. This is confusing. You better probably do it, but not realizing that you better also make sure that your broader impacts are good. So just to keep that in mind, that's not about an add-on thing. Broader impacts, because of the way NSF is set up, is so easy to be like a tack on, something that may or may not even be relevant or able to integrate to your research, but broadening participation needs to be integrated through your process, how you move through building a team, how you move through your outputs being accessible, everything.
And my experience having come to OSU has been, the call comes because people say, you know what, I understand I have to do this, I have no clue how. And this is an interesting component of both broadening participation requirements and broader impacts, is that it's hoisted upon PIs initially, right? It's the idea of, I'll do that. I don't know how to do that. I have no expertise in this. No. Not only do you have to do it with great expertise, even though you just said you don't have it. Well, how would you have it? But you will do this with great expertise, and you will do the newest thing that we know. Well, how? Well, STEM centers. Or similar kinds of institutions. This brings us back to the idea.
Yeah.
What does the institution? And I think you talked about this during lunch. The idea that in the new version of the Competes Act, there might be more brought back to the university as an institution on what the university will do to help their PIs be excellent in that by providing the kinds of resources that will allow PIs to address the issues. Because NSF, like any other federal agency, is just frustrated, of course, in the same degree that the PIs are. That they're requiring somebody to do it, to do something that everybody knows they can't.
Yeah, that's been a huge change. I don't know if you've seen that too in the discussions at NSF about acknowledging partnerships. You know, acknowledging that even on a career grant, you still don't have to do it alone. And I've had a few people who've gotten rejected from careers because they did them on their own as independents, thinking they were trained as PhDs that way, and this is a independent single PI grant that they should do it on their own, and they get rejected, and they're confused by that. It's like, well, no, you need to be guiding this. You need to be the single PI, but that doesn't mean you need to do it by yourself.
So, if I was going to start a hopefully short list of resources within a STEM center that would, you know, be critical to this, evaluation resources seem important, and people, I guess, look to their colleges of education in particular who have great expertise in that area.
Mm-hmm. Can I put a footnote on that?
Yeah,
go for it.
It happens a lot that people at universities say, well, I need an evaluation done. I go to my college of education or sociology and so on, and they find somebody who says, yeah, I'll do that. The footnote I want to make is that the function of many people in these colleges is they're the same way doing their thing as you do. They want their tenure, they want their promotion, their career. And the risk you're running is that, A, they're not evaluators, which is a completely different job than a researcher. And that's really, really dangerous to confuse. It's a different job, different mentality, different practices, different norms. A researcher is not an evaluator. But they use the same methods. So just as a, you know, it can be, but it doesn't have to be. And the second thing is, they may not serve you because they follow their own instinct. They don't have a service component. I'm not sure how you feel about this, but in the colleges of education, when you come to them and say, can you be my, and actually it's possible it happens, but the risk you're running is you find somebody who is somewhat willing, you haven't really talked for a long time, and you don't really understand that they hear something very different from what you're selling them. They want to do their thing, that has nothing to do with your thing, and then you suddenly run into trouble a little bit down the line. That said, that's, I think, where STEM centers, that's when we talk about the idea of capacity for evaluations, to know where to go when they don't know it themselves, and prevent PIs from like desperately knocking on the door of some random person in their college of education. I only wanted to say that broadly, not because, you know, because, but that's a footnote.
Well, okay, so let's just call this a generic STEM Center resource, cultural ambassador, because frankly, you need people that can actually talk to scientists on one hand and then talk to evaluators on the other and actually bridge that great vast difference in cultures.
Yes.
And a cultural ambassador also that can talk to K-12 sectors or maybe even industry sectors.
That's exactly it, yeah.
Get things done tomorrow, let's go.
Yeah, a skill set that we don't really know what to do with in the academy, right? It's something that's growing. There's some good research coming out of the UK who's a little further on what they call knowledge mobilization, which to me has a whole different kind of set of imagery than broader impacts. But they, you know, about the need for universities to meet societal demands. And I didn't share Howard's slides about kind of the public perceptions of universities and how we just fail all across the board. That's, of course, without the context of knowing that, that state funding has gone down more than other funding has gone up, and that investments per student is completely flat forever. And there's doing more with less is totally the norm. But they're looking at the makeups of universities and seeing change faster in Europe of people who they call boundary professionals or people who operate in something you might have heard the third space, right? They're brokers, they're communicators, they're translators, and they're conveners. And there's really little in the US showing that we know how to build those skills within universities. And frankly, talking to Gabrielle about Purdue's STEM Center, which is a highly successful, very chemistry-focused STEM center, she has on-staff evaluators. She's got two. She's got a quantitative-focused person and a qualitative-focused person. She can take anything in. And you know, her response is, every day I fear that I'm going to wake up to an email that says they quit because there's such a high demand. There's such a cottage industry around evaluation, and you can make a ton more money in the private sector than you can in a university. And so, knowing who to go to, I think, is probably sometimes more realistic, because evaluation, the demand for evaluation could eat a center alive.
Yeah. How does that relate to requirements for external, that evaluators be external if you're affiliated?
The requirement isn't that they're external by organization, it's that they're external from the research team.
I just wanted to point out, there are STEM evaluators, guys. Evaluation experts.
Yes.
Who work in our training. Yeah. So, you know, we don't focus at the University of Oregon here in our College of Ed. We have only a couple STEM people at all, much less STEM people who do methodological work or evaluation work. It's not, STEM is not, has not been over the years a huge focus of our particular project. But others at other universities will have their entire methodological center, for instance, will be STEM evaluators. So that's, if you go there, you have people, you don't have to have a liaison then between your evaluator and your scientist, because they are trained.
That's right. That's interesting. But that's different from a College of Education generic STEM researcher.
Yes, engineer.
But my footnote was, that is not necessarily the right path to go. If you find it, if you have a center at your college, like Outlier at the University of Chicago and others, I mean, that there are people who do that, and they are then very closely connected to the university there. It might even be better than like a shop somewhere, though I wouldn't say that. I would not say that it makes a difference whether you're university-based or private, or non-profit and so on and so forth. I want to go back to your list. You started with a good list of brokering. What
sure.
Else on your list?
Plated, of course. So cultural ambassadors, you know, to various sectors, shall we say, from the university, which has its own unique and distinct culture.
And even just in the university, you know, across departments sometimes
even
requires translation.
Colleges, you know, I mean, but then there are another key resource from my point of view are program coordinators, people that actually can run things on a day-to-day basis. And, you know, when they're run on soft money, which they often are, they develop a skill set, you know, they move on, or the program, the money, everything moves on, and then they have to redevelop a different skill set. And it seems like we're damned inefficient.
No economy of scale on that.
Actually use and support our coordinators. So what have you seen? Well, what do you do at OSU, and what have you seen elsewhere in the country in terms of STEM centers and coordinators?
I probably spend 80% of my time or more being an ambassador or managing the parts, the complexities of, you know, cross-discipline projects or cross-sector projects. And it's so not enough for what the projects actually need. I think there is a slow and growing awareness, especially in engineering, that these big complex grants, they should come with somebody who's actually directing the project, not as the PI necessarily. I mean, they can be listed as a PI, but not the not the disciplinary PI, because those are sometimes mutually exclusive skill sets. There are exceptions, of course, to that. And I can say that I tend to buffer my assessment of how much project management time is needed, and I'm always wrong. I'm always on the low end of what I think is going to be needed to manage the personalities. At a university in the Pacific Northwest that shall remain unnamed, there are these big collaborative projects that try to bring engineers and educators and physicists and mathematicians and outreach specialists and organizational management people together, and managing their epistemological differences, I'll say, it's in itself a full-time job, and managing, you know, them to be successful is itself a full-time job. So I think that that is incredible capacity to be able to offer through a STEM center. When you actually, that's a huge skill set that you really can develop and cultivate. But, you know, one person won't be able to do that for more than a couple projects at a time.
Does it pay for itself, you think?
I mean, if people write it into the grants, and that's why I mentioned engineering, because I think that the engineering directorate is starting to see that their big scale grants that have full-time project managers or project directors are being more successful. The folks in engineering that I work with have also said that they're starting to transition to somebody who's a co-PI project director, who has enough disciplinary knowledge to have the street credit to pull it off, and yet their role really is the management and not the intellectual kind of property of the grant. And I think that that's really valuable. I think it'll be a while, because in this, you know, engineering's connection with industry is so much tighter. They see that value a little bit differently.
I also say NIH has, because, and I swear it's because they work with babies, that there's just that you have to have someone who liaisons with the families and takes care of, you know, those relationships over a long period of time. But they have had programs.
IRB is something that we do a lot of.
So I come from, my root is in informal science education, and practically no project that I've ever been on doesn't have a project manager.
Yeah.
It's unheard of. That you wouldn't, nobody would think that a PI could manage the project. But that is, there's a culture against that. If you were as a PI to claim that you're the project manager, you get dinged in the review process for that, because there's no, you have no business managing the project. So that's pretty common, actually, unless it's a small research project and so on. But larger projects, no, you shall not pass. And Gandalf puts the staff down. So it's very interesting. That said, so this is another conversation we had. I certainly realize that there is, well, two risks, that they underestimate the cost of that and the effort, just as you said. Or what we also heard is there's a sense that this is somehow core funded. That it comes from somewhere. And that is certainly a large risk in terms of the planning process, and how early do people come to you, and to what degree do they put you into the grant, negotiate it with you, and so on and so forth. Sorry,
I've made the mistake, and I'm sharing this mostly for Brian's benefit, in case you're in this position of really lowballing the time needed for project management for something. And I have been for several years after that very tiny one coffee shop mistake suffered the consequences. So.
There's another related topic here I wonder if you might touch on, this idea of and where things are going, right? With, you're talking about America Competes Act, which mm-hmm. for context that folks don't know is the reauthorization that includes NSF. This idea of measuring broader impacts in aggregate. I know that the division director for engineering has talked about this, you know, the vectors lining up. And where do you see STEM centers in the role of sort of coordinating efforts on campus around broader impacts, not just for individual projects?
So I can tell you that part of my role with the National Alliance for Broader Impacts is try to understand what are all these models, what are we doing at institutional scales, and the alliance is actually trying to build a profession around broader impacts brokers, essentially, not people who do the outreach and have that expertise or do the different programming, because those are professions, those are things that have some identity with them, but the people that are working to make the matches, to make sure you've got the right kind of evaluation. Do you need somebody who's helping you adapt as you go, or you need somebody who's measuring your accountability? And so the models are so vastly different, just like STEM centers. It's the same issue, is that there's very little identity as a profession or a little idea about what are the dispositions and skills that go with brokering kind of broader impacts activities. At OSU, I can tell you what we've done. We had a big institutional effort to try to figure out what to do. And of course, you won't be surprised that the result after it got filtered with all the political filters necessary was, let's have a committee and study what we should do. And I pretty quickly figured out that wasn't going to actually ever happen. And so I said, okay, let's actually just do something else. And we started what I have referred to as a bit of a guerrilla effort. But we did get the support of the leadership to do it, and I was very upfront with them. I said, this committee thing, where's that going to get us? I don't see it happening. I don't see it getting us anywhere other than let's do more, let's examine it more, let's think about it more, let's get more volunteers to spend their time. And so we started a network, which is very loose-knit, and it's very much a social capital network, trying to match PIs with the right kinds of broader impacts that meet their desires, their passions, their own identities that are, you know, maybe they're non-research identities. If you're a musician, maybe speaking to fourth graders, it should actually have a different kind of flair to it than the average science talk. But there's lots of reasons why we've gone this route. Now, I don't know where it's going to get us. What it has done is connected people a lot. Now, other universities, Oklahoma is a good example. They, you know, they've got somebody in their research office who's the director of broader impacts. And so they're kind of like a research development person. They read your broader impacts proposal. They tell you how it's good and how it's not. They might connect you with the program. They might be establishing systems and forms for people to fill out, that kind of stuff. And then there's a lot of consulting, other groups that are consulting. So they're units that cross different divisions within a university, and they are consultants, essentially. Broader impacts consultants, they don't do the programming, but they help you interpret the NSF practices. They might call your program officer for you and figure out what's going on with broader impacts and what to expect. So I think a lot of STEM centers are taking roles in that. The National Alliance for Broader Impacts and the STEM Center Network overlap quite a lot, actually, and we're trying to kind of figure out where we delineate. And there are, I would say, maybe 40-ish STEM centers that see brokering of broader impacts as a major part of their role, and every single one approaches it differently.
I guess I would share a couple of things I'm thinking about, where we can be more systematic, like where we can have sort of a patchwork of various broader impacts add up to one larger thing. Like, could be as part of a museum, where you're supporting exhibits and different activities as a part of a museum. I'm looking at our Natural History Museum, Natural and Cultural History Museum folks. Could also be around teacher research, so you have a number of teacher research supported from different projects, all in one, you know, where you have one evaluation. You have one sort of collective pool, one program. Could be undergraduate research, similar.
Yeah.
I have other examples.
Yeah, I think the aggregate effect thing is something we're not getting even close to. And we're not really sure how to without any institutional resources. Mostly we're focused on on co-learning and innovating, you know, really. So we bring, we have events, we've done, you know, designing outreach with an empathy frame, the kind of design thinking workshop. We've done some just really core networking events. We've done, you know, meet a young PI kind of day where the early career PIs come and say what they need, what kind of broader impacts they want to do, and it's sort of more of a dating service.
Right, and you do that in partnership with your sponsored projects office?
We do it with the pats on the back and support in writing, okay. Not necessarily in budgets, of our VPR and our and our Vice Provost for Outreach and Engagement.
I was curious, just for your STEM Center, how much of your personnel, your time, and your budget is coming from being this sort of bridge between researchers and doing broader impacts and being basically on other researchers' grants versus how much time is, you know, your own grants that you're bringing in for your own programs?
90-10? 80-20? External what? Funds to...
So the funding that we generate, that we are the lead using national partners, that are external, where we're not necessarily doing broader impacts, but are involved, that's the majority of our funding right now, because that was the easiest one for me to whip up quickly when I came. Mm-hmm. But the idea, we work, and it's a major funding where we would have actually got quite a bit of funding in because we would have been part of this Center for Sustainable Materials Chemistry is currently looking to renegotiate whether it gets funded and how it gets funded, would have actually shifted this considerably. The idea, it's a little haphazard because it was easier to get Zata funding in to make the center move forward and get that staff in. But the idea behind it is indeed that we will become increasingly more the partner of those projects big enough that they are interested in understanding whether the things they're doing work. Like that, there's a research, because we are not programmers. Like we're not the SMILE program. We are not. So there's a lot of arguments that can be made for pooling the resources from many BIs that are poolable. I'm interested in K-12. I'm interested in a grad, and have programs that are existing, are flexible, take that over. So you as a PI don't have to do that. We don't do that. So we are somewhat limited in this, in that we have to be in something that is big enough that there's a need or an interest in doing research.
So the benefit to that, a lot of the BI brokering work that we do is service to the university.
Yes.
And the benefit for us being kind of in a neutral position without a program to offer is that we can kind of make a better match that could grow into a long-term relationship between a program and a PI or a group. Mm-hmm. And so that actually kind of removes me from having a sort of inherent conflict of interest that somebody might have who has a program to offer. Now, that doesn't, I think it's a rare case when bad matches are necessarily made, because I think most people who run programs don't want bad matches. They don't want to work with somebody who doesn't have the right fit or the right set of interests to really enhance their own programs. But that helps. There's a lot of those things that I think are expected of us as a center, and we do because we see it as our role to work across the silos in the university. The problem is that when your job is to work across the silos, you live in a boundary and nobody claims you when you need something, and everybody claims you when you do something. And so this is a very frequent experience of people's arms coming around our shoulders.
Oh yeah.
And then push, and then them, you know, maybe not recognizing us at the moment where, oh, these things that you love that we do, they require resources. And that is a very real challenge that I know you guys share for STEM Core.
Yes. So now, just on top of that, some of the time you're spending simply consulting with people that never can and will never result in any funding for us that we do because we want to help our colleagues is an entirely other thing altogether.
Possibly affliction that we have.
Yes. Which is great if you're core funded, right? Fantastic. But not if you're not. And the another way of thinking about this idea of getting embraced but not supported is the notion that you can make a calculation and show the university that the overall benefit of the university outweighs financial benefit of the to the university of the center outweighs the cost, the direct cost that the university invests aside from what we bring in.
but the costs accrue at a different unit than the benefits. And that is a bit of a problem when the benefits are dispersed and accrue to lots of people, and including the overarching overhead rate, F&A that the university gets, but the cost is supposed to come from this particular purse, which claims poverty, rightfully so.
So I'm going to just speak up. In the interest of equity, I have a childcare backup problem, so I have to go. But I really love that I got to talk to you guys and welcome any more conversation. So
I know we've been talking a long time, but I just wanted to invite. Invite continued dialogue. This doesn't have to be a one-time conversation. So
I agree with whatever Brian says.
and come to the National Alliance for Broader Impacts in
Yes. Oh, okay. April 26th to 28th in Stevenson, Washington. The best rate you will ever get at Skamania Lodge for $133 a night is the National Alliance for Broader Impacts fifth annual meeting. I'm the conference chair. Brian's going to have lots of jobs. I'm going to tell you about that next week. So we would love to see anybody. So this is practitioners, brokers, evaluators. There'll be some NSF people there, and lots of people kind of grappling with what should broader impacts be. And NSF is listening to this group, so it's kind of a great opportunity to not only hear from NSF, but also to kind of infuse some knowledge and information into a group that is. Got a lot of high access to.
So department heads, sponsored projects, museum folks, and associate deans should attend?
Yeah, grant writers come. there are sometimes some sponsored programs people if they're involved in design and grant drafting and things.
And
like
it was a NABI meeting in Washington that featured the first public address that France Cordova gave.
Ever.
Ever, when she became the director. So that was the first place she went to talk. Thanks to you. So at least under the current director, this is major. And it has politically, I mean, it comes from somewhere, right? I mean, would NSF do this? Would this entire organization do this if they weren't pushed? I don't know. But the push, the current political climate, in part for worse, to a degree for better, asks broader questions about why the public should fund research. And some of that discussion is really not beneficial to the research community or is very legitimate, I believe. But you follow these questions about how NSF is scrutinized for how it invests its money and how it has to testify, or how even there were claims that at some point the director of NSF needs to personally signify that the research is benefiting the taxpayer in some ways or another. So it gets to that level. But it did change the conversation a little bit around the idea, are we only talking to our little colleague circle? Or is there a thought given to some broader ways in which the research we're doing is beneficial? What Judy didn't talk about is that she's working on the concept of a broader impact identity. And that is particularly for emerging and young researchers, starting with graduate students and postdocs and going beyond, is to early on let them know that you need to be thinking about these broader pitches of what you're doing here. Not only so that their grandmother understands that at Thanksgiving dinner, but that you understand it. The claim here is not necessarily a communication issue. It is that I, as a researcher, get better at understanding what it is that I do. So you talk about meet the scientists. So part of that program that we know now of is when you train people in these programs about communicating their science to, let's say, in a materials-rich and an engaging way to 12-year-olds, it turns out you're teaching it to yourself. You know that question at the end of a dissertation defense where it says, now can you tell me what the bigger thing is that you're doing? Well, these guys can do it, these girls, because they have learned it. And that means they can pitch it, and they can write a better grant proposal, and they can have a better career. Now, how well that serves them, and everybody does that, is a different story, but it certainly helps. That's a component, I think, of the question of working with broader impacts that makes the link to a better quality research in the intellectual merit component. And that's another link that people like to see. And it's particularly important when you're beginning to look at this more cross-disciplinary, interdisciplinary realm, where people
from different disciplines need to begin to talk to one another in their languages and assumptions and so on and so forth, and develop the qualities of being more than trained towards increasingly more sophisticatedly talking to people in the disciplines. So that's a component, I think, that we will see attached to broader impacts. So one of the projects that we didn't get funded but we're still looking for is doing research as an organization that looks at learning on large teams of researchers. So there's an area called the science of team science that combines question of organizational development and organizational psychology with learning research and other kinds of things, and looks at this particularly for how we conduct research in academia. So this is different from like processes that exist, and there's lots of consulting there in the private sector and so on, so big team management and so on. This is really specifically looking at how you would do that anywhere from CERN and massive collaborations of thousands of people to your Center for Chemical Innovation, where you have a core group of PIs and an increasingly wider circle, and you're starting to have problems with how you engage them, how they work together, how the group is cohesive, and lots of issues. And so that's a ripe area, for instance, also, where the idea of broader impacts, excellence in research, and knowing something about how people learn, collaborate, teach, make meaning together, comes together. Sorry, there's a little soapbox here. But if you haven't heard about it, that is certainly an important component. By the way, another NRC report that you can download for free at nap.edu.
What's the title now?
Well, if you look at Science of Team Science, the title is different. On their search function, you will find it.
Well, thank you for engaging with Julie and Martin, and we hope to continue the dialogue and continue the conversation here on campus as well. So,
well, thanks for coming and being part of this conversation.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. And thanks, Brian.
Okay.